I'm Fibucci, and here's my tutorial about the very basics of shaders and how to become a wizard. I'll release more advanced and detailed videos in the future, also including Shader Graph, but for now, let's get started. In order to understand shaders, we have to learn a bit about meshes first. A mesh is made, usually, by triangles, which means that each triangle has three vertices. You can see the mesh as the structure of your object, built by combining its triangles together. For example, it can represent a quad, which has two triangles, a cube, a sphere, a character, etc. Now, focusing on vertices, it's important to know that each single vertex contains some data, more than its position. In this tutorial, it's necessary noting UVs. UVs are also called texture coordinates, and they let you map textures on your objects. You are basically saying to the computer, "Hey, I want this texture drawn from here to here." Think of vertices as your waypoints. If you change the UVs or texture coordinates of one vertex, you are also changing the way the texture is displayed on your mesh. This is a lot of information to digest, so let's take a moment. Now that we have scratched the topic of meshes, we can finally talk about shaders. Shaders are programs that describe the traits of vertices and pixels. In other words, via shaders, you can set and change the way the computer renders the meshes. You can also create cool effects like distortion, portals, grass, and anything a wizard can do. So let's see how they behave. The mesh info, vertices, UVs, etc., is read from the computer and is passed to the vertex shader. The vertex shader runs once per each vertex and sets your object's position on screen. It also prepares the data, like the UVs, that will be used next by the pixel shader. The pixel shader runs once per each pixel and renders your object. Here you can apply textures, that's why you need UVs, change colors, discard pixels, etc. The routine is now complete, and it will be executed again in the next frame. Let's take another pause to digest everything. After this theory, it's time for me to show you a practical example. Here we have a really basic shader. Let's focus on this part for now, between the CG program and the AndCG keywords. The code you're watching right now is exactly the routine we have discussed before. With pragma vertex vert, we are saying, "Hey computer, I want the vertex shader to be executed on this method here, called vert. Be aware that in order for them to be paired, they must have the same name." We do the same with our pixel shader. Disclaimer, there are two types of pixel shaders, one called fragment and the other one called surface. In this tutorial, we will use a fragment one, but don't worry, I'll talk about surface shaders and their differences in the next videos. As you can see, the formatting here is the same. "Hey computer, I want the fragment shader to be executed on this method here, called frag." By writing that, we have defined our vertex and pixel shaders, and it's time to begin our routine. We first need the mesh info. This is why we have this parameter here. Its type is a struct called updata, and we can declare which data we need from the mesh. In this case, we are telling Unity that we need the position of each vertex. Now that we have this info in the vertex shader, we can place each vertex on the screen, thanks to this method. We are also preparing the info for the next step of our routine. The data is a struct called fromVert to frag, and again, we are telling that this data contains each vertex position. As we have seen in our routine, the pixel shader needs this info, and it takes them from the vertex shader. That's why we can see a return on it, and the same struct. Also, to easily understand, its type is literally called fromVertex to fragment. Summing up, we now have our vertices placed in the world, but we still can see our object. Here comes the pixel shader, that runs on all the pixels and renders the mesh. In it, we are returning each pixel's color. Be aware that a color is composed by four values: red, green, blue, and alpha. This is why the mesh is red. We are returning 1, 0, and 0, and of course, the transparency is set to 1. If we want a white color, we can write all 1s, since white contains all the colors. As an exercise, try turning the mesh blue, then black, and then try creating the color yellow. Now, believe it or not, you have just passed the highest obstacle. If you get how this routine works, you are already on a good point. It's finally time to introduce properties. Be aware that I'll talk about the other things that I've left behind, like passes, subshaders, tags, etc., in the next video. But for now, to easily understand shaders in general, take them as they are. Also, the transparency of our objects in this video will always be 1. We'll understand why and we'll play with it in the next episode. Properties are variables that show up in the inspector and you can use them in your shaders. For example, let's add a variable, a number in this case, that will decide the amount of red in our color. Start writing our variable inside the properties block. Begin with our variable name, then write the label shown in the inspector, its type, and at the end, decide its default value. The semantics that you have to follow are available in the Unity documentation. You can find its link in the description of this video. Let's check if everything works. Create a material, apply your shader on it, and set it on the model. If done correctly, your model is not pink, and you can see the intensity popping up in the inspector. Now, if you want to use this property, you have to write again its type and name inside the pass. Also, the previously called fromVert2Frag is now abbreviated to V2F, which still means vertex to fragment. We wanted to set the amount of red, so let's complete the final step. As another example, let's add a color. Again, variable name, label, type and default value. Be aware that the type color doesn't exist in the shader language, but since we know that it needs four values, R, G, B and A, a float 4 will do the trick. Now we can return our property in the pixel shader. For this last example, let's render a texture. As always, variable name, label, type and default value. Then, rewrite it again in our pass. This time, the type used for textures is called Sampler2D. Also, as we have seen in this first part of this video, textures need UVs. The mesh info has to pass its texture coordinates to our vertex shader, which passes it to the pixel shader. Now we can get the color from our texture and return it. This first part has come to an end. I'll cover the things that I've left behind in the next episode, and I'll also talk about shader graph. I wanted to make a much shorter video, but it just wasn't possible as a first introduction. I do hope you are now closer to turning to a wizard. If you like my content, please consider supporting me on Patreon, since it's all made possible thanks to it. You'll also be able to watch videos in early access, read exclusive updates, download files, etc. And of course, you help me creating my games and my tutorials. Remember to subscribe, follow me on Twitter, and see you next time.